I started acting when I was 5, which is very strange for me to say now because I have a 7-year-old. And so for me to now think that my daughter could have been doing auditions for 2 years is mind-blowing to me. And so I have even more respect for my mom, who actually schlepped me around to all these auditions. But this was all me, apparently. I had seen a friend of mine who was also a kid on a television commercial one day after school, and it just got in my head. And I said, I want to do that, I want to do that, I want to do that. And my parents kept ignoring me, as you would ignore a 5-year-old saying, I want to be on TV. And then an opportunity kind of presented itself. We were in New York on a school break with the family where the son was on television, on commercials. And we were right by his manager, and the mom said, we're right by my manager, or his manager, can we stop by? I haven't seen them in a while. And then it was like the scene from The Simpsons. It's like, mom, can I go up? No. Mom, can I go up? Mom, can I go up? No. Mom, can I go up? No. Mom, can I go up? Fine, just go up. So I ran up the stairs. I met with this manager at 5, and I said, I want to be on TV. Manager said, you better go downstairs and tell your mom to park the car and come up. So I did. And my mom parked the car and came up, and we came back, took photographs, test shoots, and then she started sending me out on auditions. And a year later, I got my first commercial, which was for AIM toothpaste. And the rest is, as they say, history. The Wonder Years was a pilot. I'd auditioned for pilots before. I had been auditioning at that point for like 6 years, 5 years. And so it was a regular audition. I went in for the first audition, read. Don't remember the slides or the read. But I got a call back, did the call back read. And then I was actually in LA doing a movie when I got the third audition or the second call back to meet with Neil and Carol. And when I met with Neil and Carol, we went through our regular audition, and it was a much more untraditional. It was more of a conversation and a real, like an interview rather than an audition. I did a couple of things for them, and then when I went back home after filming the movie, I found out I got the role. We had pretty much my entire town at my house. We hosted, my mom's big at hosting parties, and we had pretty much the entire neighborhood over at my house to watch the Super Bowl, which was just a blowout. I think it was the Redskins and Bills, I think it was, and it was the Doug Williams game, I believe, where he had 4 touchdowns. I mean, it was just a blowout. So we were a little uncomfortable. We thought that they were going to get no reception and no audience. People were going to turn the game off, but we were wrong. We were wrong. The show got a tremendous following, and to get the support of the network to put that show after the Super Bowl was, again, at the time, made sense. It's a good show, that's what you do. But looking back at it, they were really supporting the show. I don't remember the time of year, but I remember specifically where I was in that house when the phone rang. I had this, it's funny that you just asked me that question, and it's funny that that just triggered this memory that I hadn't thought about in forever. But we had this, we had this chair that was a freestanding sort of chair, and I was sitting on this chair, and the phone rang, and my mom answered the phone, and she said, wow, okay, hung up the phone and said, it got picked up. And I was, I was elated. It took a long time for that to sink in. And then I flew back out to LA and we started filming the 6 episodes. We knew when we read the script that it was a very unique and special episode. It was just a special story, and the characters were really lovely characters, and there was a lot of depth to them, and there was a lot of places this thing could go. So we knew that it was good, but this was my only pilot. I had never gotten another pilot before. So it was all new to me, and my parents are, never were in the industry, so it was all new to them too. So we didn't know. We thought all pilots were sort of, like this. Otherwise, why would they be pilots? Sure enough, it's not. But then during the next 6 episodes, we realized that this was something that was exceptional. And we knew at that moment that we were all part of something that was special. It was very unique and special opportunity that we were all very much excited to be a part of. I mean, there was a feel about it, and it wasn't just the on-camera work, which was great and fun. I mean, I was 11, and it was a trip. It's all just a fun playground for an 11-year-old and for a 38-year-old. But it was the reaction. It was the reception that we got on the street and through family members and friends and the industry and the write-ups and the critical reviews. It was all just overwhelming with positivity. And we, again, it was my only experience in this. So it all felt natural to me because it made sense. It was a great show and we were doing good work and it was getting well received because it was great. And so it all made sense to me. Obviously now looking back, what an unbelievable and unique once in a lifetime opportunity and experience that I was going through. I lived in a small town. Everybody knew who I was, and not just because of I was on television, but also because we were part of the family in the town. But yeah, everyone knew what I was doing. It did change my life, no doubt about it. Some for the better, some for the worse, but it was no question that I was unique in that town. Officially, not until my junior year of high school. So I maintained that house in New Jersey through my sophomore year of high school. And I was enrolled in public school in New Jersey through sophomore year. So I would go to set, spend as much time out in LA as possible, or you know, as necessary. And then I would have my school work literally FedExed to me overnight. And then David Combs, who was a studio teacher, would intercept it and administer it. So I was doing the exact same lesson plan as my public school in New Jersey just one day later. Because we needed to have a minimum of 3 hours of school every day, which you could bank, right? The rules are you can bank hours, but you must have a minimum of 1 hour every day. So even if you're filming 10 hours a day, you have to have 1 hour of school and it only counts in 20 minutes. So if you get 18 minutes, it doesn't count. So you gotta stay in for 20 minutes. So the least amount of school you can be is 3 20-minute blocks. Can't get a whole lot accomplished in 3 20-minute blocks, but you could. And then you could bank. So there were days when I wasn't filming, I would be brought in and I would do an all day of school, like 9 hours of school. So I would bank 9 hours. So when we weren't on camera, we were in school. So when we were doing a scene and it was a two shot or a single, we were all reacting to X's or marks off camera. Fine with us, I didn't know any different, so it was fine with me. Some of the directors thought that was crazy. I didn't know any different, I didn't know anything to compare it to. I was brought into a little bit of the insight of some of the directors because one of the beautiful parts of the show is we had a lot of different directors to keep the show very unique and fresh, which was a brilliant idea. But some of the directors were not accustomed to dealing with kids. So I remember one particular episode, I will not mention, was just frustrated beyond all recognition for him that he couldn't have his actors off camera. That it bothered him, the fact that he had lost them to school and that he only had us, the kids, for a limited period of time. Just was, it was too much for him to handle. And he never came back, but he shot a great episode. I learned acting by just doing. Again, I wasn't trained. I never took any classes. I didn't do a whole lot of theater in school. I mean, I started when I was 5, right? So I just acted because I saw an opportunity to play somebody else. And I never got into the whole cerebral portion of being an actor. Not to say that's the wrong way to do it. I think that's probably the right way to do it if you want to be a professional and go on and do this as a career. But for me, it was just a kid having a good time. And the fact that the show that took place in the 60s was cool because I got to learn about a really interesting time period by quasi living through it. Like I actually feel like I kind of lived through the 60s a little bit. But people ask me, was it hard playing a kid in the 60s? And the answer is no. A kid's a kid, a kid's a kid. You know, a kid does the same things. It's just or in your surroundings. You're either going to do it in the 60s where there's marches over Vietnam, or there's doing it in the 2000s when there's, you know, Occupy Wall Street marches and protests. It's the same concept. It's just in a different time period. So I didn't have any issues with that, and I thought that was fun. yeah, Allie and Dan were extraordinarily professional. And you know, they would teach us, particularly Dan, who was such a student of theater. And whenever he had an opportunity, he would corral us individually or all together and grab us by the scruff of our necks and sit us down in front of a television and put on old movies and just force us to watch these movies. And for that, I am incredibly grateful to him for understanding the art of filmmaking. And seeing the evolution of the old school film into the new school film, and then theater sort of is the underlying skill set behind all of that. Which is interesting because my first real thing that I did aside from commercials or television stuff before the Wonder Years was theater. I did theater, but I was an understudy for a very small role. But I actually went to the stage every day for over a year, and I learned the backstage life. So I had that. To, I think Dan respected me a little bit because I had some theater experience. You are not an actor until you have done some theater. You know, that's actually a pretty common sentiment. You see a lot of people who have made their mark in television or film, and then they come back to theater and they all say, it's transformed me as a person and as an artist. Theater is wonderful. You never know what you're going to get in theater. It's, you know, you have this set of lines and scenes and blocking, but literally each performance is something different. You can try something new, and you never know how the audience is going to react. You don't know how you're going to feel, and it's a wonderful way of exploring yourself as an artist, no doubt about it. You know, in television, less so in our show because we were done in a unique way. But you know, you do your lines, you take your shot, you move on to the next scene. First of all, Neil and Carol were t they were they were tireless in their auditioning. I mean, they started in LA and then they brought in their search to Chicago and New York. I mean, they went everywhere to find this cast. So again, looking back at it now, the fact that I was chosen for it was an unbelievable honor. I mean, I know they cast this for this role in multiple cities. So I was handpicked, which is quite a treat. The entire cast and crew, it's very important to include the crew. Knew that this was a family, this was kids. We had, you know, talked about it before. The whole experience was focusing on children. So everything on set had to be completely clean, right? Everything was clean. In terms of behavior, in terms of personalities, in terms of school, in terms of professionalism, there was a very significant strain of professionalism with a childlike fun. And there was a lot of tolerance for the fact that the principals were kids. We used to, in between breaks, if we didn't have school, enough time for school, we would go get R&R. It would go play, literally, we'd go play. And we would come back sweaty because we'd either be playing basketball or later on in the show, the ping pong matches got really competitive. And we would come back all sweated up. You know, and they're boys. You know, Fred and I we were boys. We did sports. We you know, Fred was a catcher. I was a pitcher. We would play, you know, baseball together, and we played basketball together. And the crew was all involved in that. So it really was. I know it's cliched, but it really was a family. It really was a very controlled environment. And because of that, we were all very well protected, and we were really able to do the things that we wanted to do. And we were all good kids. We were all good kids. We all had good parents. We all had good crew members to keep us in line. And even the most outlandish things we would do were completely within the realm of normal for teenagers. Certainly in the realm of normal for teenagers in the industry. Right? I mean, you don't hear any of those horror stories from any of us, which is great. And I think it's a testament to not just us and our parents, but also the crew. And so, yeah, you know, dealing with the crew and dealing with the other actors, and particularly the older actors. I mean, the older. Sorry, Dan. Sorry, Allie. Sorry, Olivia. You know, they treated us like their children, and we treated them like our, you know, maybe big brothers and big sisters. He was the boss. He ran that crew better than anyone ran anything. I looked up to Skip in every way. He was a great person. He was the reason why we were kept in line. He was fun, And he could do things that we couldn't do, because that's Skip. And that was Skip. And he would keep us in line. He would call us over. Josh, get over here. Get over here. You can't do that. That is not acceptable. I'm not going to tolerate that. Why, Skip? Because that's not right, and you know it. Okay, Skip. Sorry. You're right. Now, he was a wonderful person. Oh, wonderful person. You knew Fred was good. What I always saw as Fred as being so talented on was his ability to be as expressive as he was at such a young age with such subtle movements, right? You can't do that in theater. You can't almost can't do that on in film. You can do it on television because, particularly because of the role, right, with the narration, and he does his facial expressions, and we made fun of him all the time for the look, you know, the one eyebrow up, and then he can do the other eyebrow, and I still can't do it. But, you know, at one point, the director used to say, he coined that, you know, that was Fred's look. Directors would say, we need the look there, and he'd be like, left eyebrow or right eyebrow? But he was so, and obviously because of the reaction that the industry was giving him, and he was nominated for Emmys, and he was the role, and the role was him, and he was really, really good. Really, really good, and we knew that. But I also think that the whole cast was really, really good. And when you put quality people next to quality people, it's like, you know, a sports team. You just make everybody better around you. And again, that's one of those things where I think I realized that after the fact, not while I was going through it. But very rarely did I have an issue or did I struggle with things. I was the giggler. I used to giggle all the time. I would lose it. I had a hard time keeping a straight face. I would ruin takes left and right because I was giggling. But we got through it. Kevin was, I think he was supposed to represent the everyman, the every person. And as a result of that, he was sort of the neutral one, right? So a lot of things happened to him. And his character was the reaction. He was the reactionary kid. He was the person who he would get into a situation, things would happen to him, and how would he respond? And that's how the show was written. And so as a result of that, all the other characters that interacted with him had their role, but he was, you know, he was the everyday person. So I think you see a lot of what you're supposed to feel growing up through that character. Everyone can relate to him. But I don't think any one person is Kevin Arnold. I think you can have people who are Paul, who are that role. And I think you have people who could be Winnie. And I think you have people who are some of the other friends. You can relate to those people. Everybody could relate to Kevin at certain times. But I don't think that there's any one person out there who lived the Kevin Arnold life. I think that's an amalgamated character, which is great, right? And that's exactly what great storytelling is. Somebody that you can relate to. But when you look back on it and say, like, yeah, that's not really how I was. And so I have a lot of people who, through Twitter or through other social media, have said to me, I always wanted to be or always looked up to Kevin, which is true. Everybody wanted it. It was a great life. I mean, he had a great adolescence, right? But when you really think about it, I'm really more of a Paul. Or I'm really more of a Wayne. Or I'm really more of a, of any of the other players, Jeff or, you know, Vonnie's character. So I think that his character represented the storytelling, almost like this mythological creature. I think that her character has evolved, probably evolved the most, I think. I think that there was a lot more depth given to that character over time than was originally intended. And I think that's a testament to Danica. I mean, she made that character hers. That's, you know, Danica was Winnie and Winnie is Danica. I think that her character was really supposed to represent the old, you know, that neighborhood girl that we all had a friend, and then you go through adolescence and you're confused, and then they're there, and well, what are these feelings? Are they friendship feelings? Are they romantic feelings? And so, you know, also it makes for a good storyline, right? I mean, you know, are they together, off again, off again, on again, off again, on again? You know, most shows have that dynamic. Her character, as it evolved and they gave her more depth, they didn't focus on a lot of her struggles, but they were there. And I think if you look back at it now, which I haven't done in a long time, but especially as an adult, I think you're going to see, or I think I'm going to see, that there was a lot of depth there that was possibly overlooked during the first broadcast. Another reason why you don't really notice that her struggles or struggling is are real is because you're seeing it through the perspective of a 13, 14, 15-year-old boy who, for the most part, I mean, we're all oblivious. I mean, we don't know what's going on, right? I mean, I'm 38 and I'm still oblivious. Boys are oblivious. While I was, I think, quite different from Paul, the spirit of the character is really the spirit of me. I mean, you know, he was a piece of me, and I was a piece of him. And so I was a really good, fun, wholesome, genuinely nice kid. And that showed, I think, I mean, that shone through in the character. And yeah, he was a lot more, you know, nerdish or however you want to describe him, but he was a good friend and honest and loyal and he was the kid that everybody wanted as your best friend. And I don't know, I'm not quite sure what they saw. I mean, maybe that's because I thought I was a genuinely good, honest, and loyal kid. But, you know, in terms of athleticism, which is often the demarcation in high school or junior high school between nerdy and not nerdy, right? It's whether you're athletic or whether you're confident or whether you have a skill set or whether you're doing something that inspires some sort of confidence in yourself. I was somewhat athletic when I was a kid, and I was always on a sports team, and I was always playing sports. So in that regard, I was probably the most different from my character. But at the end of the day, he was a really good kid. He was a really good character, and I'd like to think that I was some big part of that.